For more on the 2021 budget deliberations, we are now joined by Finance Assistant Secretary Antonio Lambino. Hi, ASEC Tony. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning, Michelle, and thank you for having me.
So ASEC, I know in less than an hour, you're going to walk into day two of Senate deliberations on the 2021 budget. So you're looking at 4.5 trillion pesos, up 10% from 2020. The biggest allocation still goes to the Department of Education, 754.4 billion, followed by DPWH, DILG, DND, and at the number five spot is Department of Health. As ASEC Tony, at a time when we're facing the worst health crisis of the century, why isn't health top of the list?
Well, top of the list is education, because that's what the Constitution requires. And that includes allocations for Dept, Ed, state universities and colleges, CHED and TESTA. In terms of our recovery program, making sure that the whole country bounces back, the lead initiative is really the infrastructure program, the build program, because it has the largest multiplier effects in an economy. And that is evidenced by the numerous projects all over the country, tens of thousands of them, both large and small, that are bringing more economic activity, well, at least pre-pandemic, not to those areas. And we need to keep investing in those things, because those will give us the largest returns, in terms of the whole of society. Interior and local government, Michelle, includes the internal revenue allotments. So that also is by law required. The health department is, according to the submitted national expenditure program, includes actually a pretty large increase, compared to last year. I believe it's more than 20%, if I'm not mistaken.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The DOH is asking for a bigger slice as well, 203 billion pesos combined already. That's up 27%. ASEC, do you think this is enough to be able to respond to the health crisis?
Well, Michelle, I need to defer to the Department of Health on the details of their proposal. Suffice it to say that these are all priorities that have to go together. Just for instance, we did a large enterprise survey to ask businesses what they need to bounce back. So we need to address the health issue. We also need to get Filipinos back to work. It's not an either or. We have to do both. And in the first few months of the pandemic, we were treating it as novel. Remember, we used to call it the novel coronavirus because it was new. Now we kind of know a lot more about how the virus is transmitted. And we know the types of behavior that we need to adopt individually and as groups in order to reduce the risk of infection. It's very simple. Wear your mask, watch your distance, wash your hands frequently, disinfect surfaces that we're not sure have been disinfected, etc. So we know that, and it's not so new anymore. We can reduce, according to the experts, the risk of infection by adopting the right behaviors. I've seen estimates between 80 to 95%, at the individual level. So what do we need to do? We need to bring back consumer confidence. Right. So in addition to the health interventions, which are critically important, we also need to make sure that we bring back a functional level of public transportation. We need to make sure that businesses have access to credit. In fact, in terms of the survey that I mentioned earlier, there were the top three things that businesses asked for, and there were 47,000 businesses that responded to the survey. The first is cash transfers, which 46% of them said they needed, and 46% said they received through the small business wage subsidy, perhaps some through the SAP for their informal sector workers. Now, the second thing they asked for, new loans with subsidized interest. We have proposed to Congress a measure called FIST, the Financial Institution Strategic Transfer Act. And this will allow banks to offload their souring loans, their non-performing loans and assets, and we expect the number to start going up over the next few months post lockdown, right? And 36% of the 47,000 respondents said they need this. Only 8% said they had received this. So the FIST bill is critically important. Mm-hmm. The third highest in the survey was tax exemptions or reductions. 23% requested this, and zero had received it. That is why the CREATE bill is so important, because it will lower the corporate income tax for almost all businesses. More than 99% of our businesses are micro, small, or medium enterprises, and they are asking for tax reduction relief. Mm-hmm. And that is why the CREATE bill is so important to pass, no? As soon as possible time. So what I'm saying, Michelle, is that we have to see these things as a set. It's the Bayanihan 1, Bayanihan 2, FIST bill. There's also the guide bill to help in terms of insolvency of companies. You have the CREATE bill. And these things in combination will help our economy bounce back. Mm-hmm.
ASIC, Tony, I imagine it's a pretty tough balancing act for economic managers today, led by DOF, you guys, of course, to sustain the spending and continue stimulating recovery despite revenue shortfall and what more shortfalls in the future with these tax exemptions requested by businesses. How is their balance sheet looking today?
Well, we came into this pandemic with one of the healthiest balance sheets we've ever had. Mm-hmm. Now, revenues were at a 22-year high last year. Our spending, especially on the infrastructure program, despite the delayed passage of the 2019 budget, was able to catch up. No? We were able to get the spending going in the second half of last year. So we came into this with a very strong fundamentals, which is why the lenders are willing to provide credit to us for those shortfalls that you mentioned. And we are incurring those shortfalls, and we will as well for the next couple of years, no? at higher levels than initially expected. But because our credit rating had been upgraded last year, S&P upgraded us from BBB to BBB+. Even within the pandemic, the Japan credit rating agencies looked at the management of our finances and our debt, and they upgraded us in June, in the heat of the lockdowns, from BBB+ to A-. That is why we're able to access credit at lower interest rates and longer repayment periods, and that will benefit the Filipino people over the long run. We have to be very careful with the money that we borrow now, because we will be paying for it into the future. The next generation will be paying for it. And so we have to make sure that we spend this money wisely, prudently, in things that we really need, such as pandemic response measures, as well as the infrastructure program that we talked about earlier, because that will provide the ballast in order for the economy to recover and for a private enterprise to rebound. Now, it's also important to note that government spending is a percentage of the economy. You know, the larger percentage is really private enterprise. And we need to make sure that consumer and investor confidence come back. This is not going to be a walk in the park between now even and when the vaccine is broadly available. It will take some time. The best estimates are at some point next year. Some people say early next year, some people say late next year. That's why Secretary Dominguez keeps saying we need to keep our powder dry. We can't spend everything right away. We need to make sure we phase our expenditures so that we can battle this pandemic as long as it takes, mm-hmm. until we get that vaccine broadly distributed and applied to the population.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. ASIC, Tony, I wanted to end with this question. Fitch Ratings on Monday came out with a report, and the report said they expected the Philippines to show the worst slump among ASEAN economies. They're looking at an 8% contraction for this year for the Philippine economy versus their initial estimate of about 4% drop or contraction. Versus, so our 8% contraction versus Thailand's 7.8% contraction versus Singapore's 6% contraction, or Malaysia's 2.5% contraction, or Indonesia's 2% contraction. And of course, Vietnam, do we even have to say it? They're not looking at contraction, but they're looking to grow 2.8% this year. Our government is looking at a 4.5 to 6.6% contraction for this year. What are they seeing that we're not, or vice versa? What are we seeing that they're not, if you want to look at the glass half full?
Yeah, well, the point estimate that was presented to the Senate yesterday by Acting Secretary Chua, Carl Chua of NEDA, was that we're looking at a 5.5% contraction. That's been adjusted upward by the Development Budget Coordination Committee. But we are watching all of the numbers, of course. If you look at our imports and our exports, there have been bounces already post ECQ. Our unemployment rate, which was at 17.7%, I believe in April, is now at 10%. So there are numbers that are showing signs of recovery. Now the challenge is to make sure that we keep that going. No, we can't keep going into lockdowns. That will actually change the landscape and the estimates drastically. We have to make sure that we follow the health protocols, that we invest continually in the right things so that we reduce that contraction as much as possible. But we'll keep watching those numbers, Mimi. We're looking at, as I mentioned, the 5.5% estimate at this point. And we are also seeing some signs of recovery. But again, there are downside risks, such as a severely extended pandemic. There are potentials in terms of weakening or slow recovery in other parts of the world that tend to be our trading partners. And the largest risk is that we do not follow the health protocols and go back into second or third waves. So we want of lockdown. So we want to avoid that as much as possible, bring back a confidence of our consumers and our investors by sharing the best information that we have in terms of reducing the risk of transmission. And as I said in the beginning, this is no longer a new virus. We have learned a lot about it. We know what we need to do in order to protect ourselves and our loved ones, our households, and our offices.
Okay, on that cautiously optimistic note, thank you very much, ASEC, for joining us this morning.